My Dhamma brothers and sisters and friends, today I'm going to give a talk on healing difficult emotions, freedom from fear. The word, the Pali word is baya, fear, so you want to be a baya. If you have fear in your life, you can call yourself what? Baya. If you want to be fearless, you call yourself Abaya. So if you have fear or you're planning to have fear, this talk is good for you. All right? So we start with okay. We start with emotion because fear is an emotion. So in Latin words, it's imovere, emovere, which means to agitate. In Middle French, word is émouvoir, which means to stir up. So those who have ever experienced emotion, I think they can relate to these words. Eh? It seems there's something churning, you know, stirring up. And then the Pali word for emotion is chittavagga. Chittavagga. The word, there's a chitta, the word there, so the mind is very clear there. It's a part of mental formation, the fourth aggregate of subject to clinging. Of course, we have different emotions also, like wholesome emotion, like loving kindness, compassion, joy, gladness. And also we have what to call unwholesome emotions, difficult emotions such as greed, hatred, and fear. So the thing that most of the time when people talk about emotions, they always think about only negative emotions. But actually there's positive emotions, like calmness, joy. So unfortunately, that's why that's what people do. Whenever they say, "Oh, I have strong emotions," people just think about only fear and hatred and all these things. But there are more positive emotions that we need to cultivate actually if we are to progress on the path to liberation. So we have to distinguish between what's wholesome emotion and unwholesome emotion. So unwholesome emotions, I'm just talking about difficult emotion because they're very difficult to deal with. So cause of fear. From Dhammapada, we found out the cause of fear is from attachment. In fact, the Buddha said from attachment springs grief, from attachment springs fear. So where there is no attachment, there is no fear, there is no grief. So there's also fear that arises from imagination, mistaking a rope for a snake, right? That's definitely clear imagination. So it has nothing to do with attachment, but you just imagine. In fact, it's called distorted perception. The perception is distorted. So here is an acronym that I got from the internet. Fear means false evidence appear real. And I think you can relate to this. Some of the things that we are afraid, they're not real. For instance, being afraid of a ghost. In Australia, are you afraid of ghosts? Not so. What about Sri Lankan? Big time. In Africa, big time. Big time. As a young boy, even during that time, I was afraid to pass near grave. It's amazing what now I love to meditate in the graves, you know? In fact, I love it. We went somewhere, Spring Valley Botanic Garden. Actually, even it doesn't have the word grave, so already there's no fear. So it's a garden. So you go there. And it's amazing. We went there as a group of us from Buddhist Society of Victoria. We went there, I think we were five of us, four. We went there and we toured the place. Actually, the place can have even a hotel, I think, lodging. It's so beautiful. And guess what? They have done one wedding there. There's a couple. Is it not a wonderful thing that cemeteries can begin to be a marriage destinations, where when you want to get married, you just go and marry there? That will remove the whole fear about where you go after death. Yes, it's such a beautiful place. I've never seen a cemetery like that, actually. It's amazing. It's so beautiful. When I was growing up as a kid in Uganda, I had this something called ghost, especially in the dark. They told me, don't go in the dark because they are ghosts. I think what they wanted me is not to really hit myself in the ditches and break my leg. I don't know why. What was the motivation behind it. So now, as I was growing up, I started asking the person who told me that the ghost is going to eat you. I say, have you ever seen a ghost? He said, no, I've never seen a ghost. I said, can you tell me the person who has seen a ghost? He said, no. Wait a minute, let me remember. He told me somebody who has seen a ghost. I went to that person. He said, I was told also. So every time I was meeting the people, I said, I was told that there's a ghost. So I thought this is imagination. I became a monk, and I went to Thailand, and it was a conference. And I decided to, after the conference, to go to Ajahnicha Monastery in northern Thailand. And I went to Pananacha, and visited all these monasteries where they have cremation. And I landed in another monastery where there was a monk who doesn't speak English very well. And then he told me he has seen ghosts. I said, this is a monk, I cannot lie. So I said, yes, finally I found out somebody who has seen a ghost. I said, let's go. I was so excited. So we went with this monk. We didn't speak enough English. And it was around 10 p.m. And it was getting dark. And then we went. We went in the middle of a monastery. In fact, this cemetery, they don't cremate, but they bury dead bodies. And usually these are bodies which had accidents. They think that if they cremate it, they will not do a good job. So they wait for a while before they cremate them because they had an accident. So they don't bury them so deep, just pretty much on the surface. So I went there, sat in a small hut, and meditated, shaved head. Now I kept on meditating. The monks say, okay, here you are going to see ghosts. I'll come back after 1 hour. I kept on meditating. All of a sudden, something starts making sound. Pack! 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 I said, this is it. I said, but it's dark. I said, what is going to happen? I don't have a flashlight. I said, I heard that it can make its own light, actually. I said, okay, no problem. I said, no, maybe it's not a good idea to close the eyes. You should open them. I opened my eyes, waited, but I thought maybe it's a branch breaking, actually. So then I waited. Then meantime, this mosquito were biting me, really eating me alive. This is like mosquitoes in Thailand, they cause dengue fever as compared to mosquitoes in Uganda, which give you malaria. So I was comparing, oh, I've come from Uganda, maybe I have malaria, now I'm going to get dengue, maybe I'm going to die. So a lot of emotions. I was so much wrapped up with my emotions, I even forgot about the ghosts. Because I've ever got actually dengue fever when I was a layman in Thailand. I was a scuba dive instructor. And I got this dengue fever. And I heard that if you get dengue for the second time, kaput, dead. Then the fear of death started coming. I say, yeah, no, if you die, that's okay, actually. After all, you have established Buddhism in Africa and in Uganda. People are going to keep on practicing Buddhism. And my mother, they are practicing Buddhism. So there's no problem when I die. So I talked like this to myself. Then all of a sudden I heard somebody walking. Ta, ta. I knew that this is now a ghost. And guess what? This was a monk who's coming to fetch me. But he didn't put on a flashlight. Yeah, and then I stood up, of course, to do walking meditation. And I think that was the end. I never seen the ghost. And up to now, I want to see a ghost. My audience, if you have ever seen a ghost, please let me know. Because I feel that the best way to overcome fear of ghosts is to face the ghost. It would be wonderful, actually, get the ghost come and say, hey, sit here, do you want some lunch? And we can share dana. Yeah, and we can meditate together. I'm so frustrated that up to now I've never seen a ghost. If he has ever seen one, send it to me as a guest. Can be my guest. Yes, so a lot of kids actually have a lot of fear in Uganda. Right, we talk about analogy, painting tigers. There's a person who was very good at painting tigers, right? He painted tigers from day 1, 2, 3, 1 month, 3 months, and it was a perfect tiger. Perfect, beautiful work of art. Put it in a living room. Went out for a little walk, and came back at dark, when it was dark, opened the door, not enough light. He thought there was a tiger in his room, and started running away. Can you imagine, most of our fear is about painting tigers? It's one thought after one other, and we pile it, and at the end we forget that we are the one who even piled it. Can you imagine when we look at an artist? They spend a lot of time getting canvas and paint and good paint, and it's not only one day job actually. When we're doing painting, it takes a while, and if when it's perfect, then we are afraid. I'm not a good painter, but I remember when I was in West Virginia, I had one day of meditation, and then usually I don't put a chair outside my kuti, but for this specific day, I decided to put a chair outside my kuti. A place for where monks stay. And then I sat meditating on a chair because there was beautiful sunlight. And then I forgot to put it back. And then at the evening, when it was getting dark, I remembered the rule for a monk. There's a rule for monk to take care of sangha property. Yeah? We cannot leave it outside. So I said, okay, let me see if there's anything that that's outside. So then I opened the door. When I opened the door, the chair was stuck with the door. And then all of a sudden I thought maybe it's actually a deer or what we call a bear. Because I've seen a bear before. That's another story. I told you about that. I thought it's a bear. But you look at it. I'm the one who put the chair there. And I forgot that I put the chair there. And now I'm thinking it's a bear. So really, actually, most of the fear that we have, we usually are the one who planted there. In fact, the only fear is the fuel that we give it. When we give it more fuel, it becomes more strong. When we starve it with less fuel, it becomes less and less and less. I think this is very important to remember to stop paying tigers. Okay, let's go to kinds of fear. One of them, fear of the future. If something happened in the future, you don't want to repeat it. And that's understandable. Thus, we lived in this world whereby we lived with our friends, tigers and anacondas, all these wild animals. The brain had to actually take all the details. If you meet a lion one time, the brain will take all the details so that next time you don't have to meet Mrs. Lion, Lioness, or Mr. Lion. So what the mind does is to conjure up all imaginations, right? All details so that you don't repeat the mistake. So, but then there's no lions, but still there's some kind of fear that something is going to happen, especially if something has happened to before, which is understandable actually. So, but it's a problem sometimes if we are not mindful of it. This one I got from the internet. If you live in fear of the future because of what happened in the past, in your past, you end up losing what you have in the present moment. So, fear is no more. Actually, it's a no more emotion. I'm not blaming people who have fear. Actually, you can overcome fear when you attain the third level of enlightenment. Before that, you have to be mindful of it, right? You have to be mindful of it. So, you know that, okay, there's a fear of the future, and it's okay to have fear of the future, but the only thing you don't want to lose your life, right? You don't want it to lose your life. Okay, other kinds of fear. Fear of death. That's a big one. Fear of death in our life. Isn't it? Who is not afraid of death? Ah, very good. Yes, yes, I can see. All right. So then fear of failure. Who's afraid of failure? Okay, I think most of us. Okay, fear of success. Who is afraid of success? Actually, most people are afraid of success. Why? Because success comes with responsibilities. Success comes with responsibilities. Okay, do you want to be the president of USA? Good luck. In fact, there's a friend of mine who supported Obama to become a president. But after he became a president, he said, I feel very bad about it because it's too much responsibility. Actually, I tell you, my gut feeling, as a monk, but there's no rule, I think. I mean, to become a president, I will be very happy, actually. I will establish all monasteries around Africa, everywhere. I'll build monasteries everywhere, temples, meditation center, all over the world, actually. But I don't want to be a president because of responsibility. Actually, that's why most people are afraid to be even successful, because success comes with duties and responsibility. To become an abbot is a responsibility. Don't you think so? I didn't know that. When I started Uganda Buddhist Center, I didn't know what I was getting into. After establishing the temple and all people are interested in Buddhism, now I see the responsibility I have, you know? A lot of responsibility. It's like, actually, a temple is like a human being. Eh? You have to feed it. You have to maintain it. You can't leave it fall apart because people are benefiting, you know? So it's a lot of responsibility. Ah, fear of in-laws. Don't worry if you are eating right here. Don't take it personal. It's a very common thing. Eh? Fear of exams, fear of the unknown, even fear of fear. You know, fear of fear. You know when people are afraid and then they feel that they're afraid? They become afraid of being afraid. Fear of being fear. It just keep on going on. Fear of public speaking, not me, definitely. I enjoy it. I have fun. Public speaking is not my problem. You can add more fears if you want, a lot of fear. But there are many, but fear of unknown actually is very common. Okay, let us, all of us, go to Uganda. And you'll see, oh yeah, I have to paint my house. But people don't say actually it's fear of unknown, but they just find something else to do. Because they don't know what's in Uganda. What is to expect? I'm telling you, I invited monks to come to Uganda for the first time. I'm telling you, some of them even dropped out. They say, you know, we had the president is fighting with the opponent, but there's nothing. I mean, it's just nothing, really. Who doesn't have a quarrel with their wife or husband? So the same with the politician. When somebody becomes a president, will have a quarrel with the opponent. But monks could not come. Another monk asked me question until the last moment he flew. He's from Burma. I'm telling you, he's staying with us for 1 year, but I'm telling you, oh, what if I come to the immigration and they deport me? I'm going to lose all the money for the dayaka. Oh, so many things. Fear of unknown is very, very common. All right, so we go to another one. Fear of death. So this is from the scripture. Four kinds of persons who fear death. So these are the four kinds of people. One, who is not free from lust for sensual pleasures. One, who is not free from lust for this body. One, who has not done anything good or wholesome. And one who has made shelter for himself. Actually, this is has not made shelter for himself or herself, but has done what is evil? Yeah, so please change this one to not, right? I don't want to disrupt the slide, right? And then one who has doubts and perplexity about the Dhamma, and he or she not come to certainty of the Dhamma. So these are the four people. 1, 2, 3, 4. This sentence should continue with this one, right? So there are four kinds of people who are going to be afraid of death. Thereupon, when somebody gets sick, any of those four people, when they get sick, they grieve, they mourn, and then they're afraid of death, right? So this is the people. If you are one of them that who is free from lust for the body, you won't have afraid, you won't have fear for death, because you say, okay, you have let go the body. Okay, this is I don't mind what happens to the body when it's is dead. But if you say, oh, my body, I'm going to lose my body, you know, then you have a lot of fear of death, you know. But after all, actually, when you die, you just get a new body, right? It's like having a car which is old and all, and just get a brand new one. I don't know actually why people are afraid of death. You get a new set of arguments, new one. When you look at babies, whoa, I'm telling you, they're so beautiful. I'm telling you, it's very difficult to say baby who's ugly and who's beautiful. All of them are beautiful because they have a new set of aggregate. So actually acquiring a new set of aggregate of clinging when you're born, reborn, is fun. Okay, so freedom from fear. There are four kinds of person who do not fear death. I think you're going to be one of them. Somebody actually raised their hand. Yeah. You see our friend here? He's not afraid of death. Okay, one who is free from lust for sensual pleasures. Mm-hmm. Right? One who is free from lust for this body. Right? And another one, one who has done good or for something. That means somebody who has kept good precepts. You shouldn't be afraid of death. Why? Because that's your karma. Good karmas, as soon as you're born, your karma is waiting for you. As soon as you die, it's waiting for you. Good existence, right? So if you have done good, you shouldn't be afraid of death because you have done good things, right? Yeah. Then another thing is, of course, one who has made a shelter for himself or herself and has not done anything evil and or wicked. Another one who has no doubts or perplexity about the Dhamma, and then who has gained certainty in the Dhamma. Thereupon, when this person falls sick, he does not grieve or mourn or is not afraid of death. So this is what I was talking about. Practicing the five precepts at the minimum give you freedom from fear and also give freedom to all beings, of course. Now, friends, if you want to be free from death, practice the five precepts, and that means you are going to have a store of good karmic forces that when you pass away, you don't end up in unwholesome, unwoeful states of mind. You end up in awesome states of mind and wholesome states of mind. All right. What have we to do? Wow, there's something we have to say here. All right. Okay. Of course, maybe most of us were not free from lust and sensual pleasures, but at least how about when we try to do what's wholesome? Let us try to do as much as possible wholesome deeds. And then whenever this fear of death arises, then we can remember them. You remember my incidents in Thailand when I was meditating and I had a fear of a ghost? You remember what I said? I've done good things. Eh? I've established a temple, and people there are meditating. So if a tiger eats me, no problem. Actually, also I remembered of tigers, eh? Not tigers, tigers. I have to be very clear in my pronunciation. I heard about Ajahn Man meditating, those tigers coming and all these things. Actually, I thought of, because I was doing walking meditation, I said all of a sudden, when the tiger comes from the forest and eats me, what's going to happen with my temple? I said, oh,
let go about the temple. People are meditating there, right? So it's very good to remember that you've got done good things. This is the way how to overcome fear. Okay, this part of practicing five precepts, the Buddha said that when you practice five precepts, you have actually you give what we call freedom from fear. In other words, you give what you call abhaya dana, freedom of fearlessness. People think that, oh, you know, I don't have money to give to the temple. I don't have money to do that, to give. But the Buddha talk about the great dana. Actually, the great dana, generosity, is to be able to give. One of them is to be able to give the gift of fearlessness. That's a great gift. But guess what? The Buddha said that when you give this gift, you become a shareholder. Also, you share in that gift. So in other words, it's not about giving only fearlessness, but also you share in that gift. I remember in Uganda there was a war, and I mean, in Uganda you could not travel around 6 p.m. We are afraid to be killed. But when the new president came, I was so surprised people were traveling midnight because they were not afraid to be of being killed. So I saw this happening in Uganda, and it's not a Buddhist country. So when people are afraid that their life is going to be taken away, they are not afraid that their things are going to be taken away, they are freedom from fear. Like you leave your mobile phone here, you'll find it. You leave it here, you come tomorrow, you find it. Yeah, you are not afraid that somebody is going to take your mobile phone. All right? All right, so let's go to another one. There is two kinds of fear that Buddha talks about that are the one which are worth practicing. One is called moral shame and moral dread. And these are the two qualities, we call them hiri and otapa, this one. The two qualities of mind is called sukha lokapala. Those are what we call guardians of the world. In fact, these are two states of mind. They are the one which protect the world. Right? But we have to qualify them. Instead of saying fear, we call them moral fear. There's a difference here. And that's what we should have, actually. Other kind of fears, we just have to work on it and deal with it. So this is called hiri, moral shame of doing evil or wrong, or disgust at evil. This innate sense of shame or over moral transgression. It's an internal reference. And its proximity cause is self-respect. In other words, you respect yourself, and then you don't do something, right? Like, for instance, for me, as a Ugandan, as a monk, I may not do something out of self-respect as a monk. In other words, you're not going to see me jogging in robes. You find me walking around, but not jogging because of self-respect. Eh? That would be called moral shame. But this, if you don't qualify this as moral, shame is not something that should be practiced. You are ashamed to talk. No. This is called moral shame. It's okay to have what you call moral shame. But shame, that means you are shy or something like that. So it's good to distinguish these two things. There's another Pali word you need to learn. It's called otapa. Otapa, it's what you call moral dread or fear of going wrong or going evil or doing evil. So this is dread or fear of the results of doing evil, blame or punishment by others, and unwholesome karmas. And its proximity cause is respect of others. Visuddhimagga, this is from Visuddhimagga. Visuddhimagga gave an analogy. This is an analogy Visuddhimagga gave. Yeah? I don't know how to shut off that thing. There was a machine that shuts off. Anyway, look here now. Don't look up there. So you see this stick? If this stick is hot, actually, this is a good analogy. If this stick is hot, this brown one, and this is dirty. So hiri, which is the moral shame, will be being afraid to touch this dirty part. Because when you touch this dirty portion of the stick, you get dirty, isn't it? So you have shame, you know? You know, everybody look at me, I'm smelling. Oh, sorry, not smelling. I'm dirty. I'm dirty, you know. So there's what we call hiri. Otapa is red one. What happens when you touch fire? It burns you. So you'll be afraid of the consequences which are going to burn you. This distinction is very important, the analogy of a stick, right? Because most people don't know how to distinguish between he and otapa, which is moral shame and moral fear. I hope you remember this analogy, right? So this is what actually we should have, and the Buddha encouraged that one. So let's go to healing. How can we heal difficult emotions? Because we can see sometimes they can debilitate us. What about fear of not getting sick? Where are you going to put it? Is it okay to eat good food because you're afraid to get sick? I think that's okay. It's okay. Nobody should blame you. But there's some fear which is a little bit unwholesome. Fear about being fear and all this kind of thing. Okay, let us take a case study of freedom from fear. That's the case study we are going to take now for our talk. So if you want to be free from fear, this is number one. Always number one is, guess what? Mindfulness. It's amazing what mindfulness can do. If you ever get confused about anything, whether in anxiety or whatever, your number one approach always to be mindful, right? So this is whereby you recognize or become mindful of the emotion, any emotion. We take, for example, fear. So we become mindful of the presence and absence of fear. Okay, what does mindfulness of the presence of fear help us? This is how it helps us. Because whenever there's a fear, there are two things happening. One is the object of fear. Another one, fear itself. Right? Let's say when you are going to give a talk, a Dhamma talk, or a talk, and then you start shaking, a lot of fear. What's going on there? One is the object of fear. In this case, can be the people staring at you. Another one is the fear itself in a mind state, which is here in the mind. It has nothing to do with the people who are observing. You are the one who has the fear in the mind because you have not overcome greed and aversion and all these things. So now, how to work with this fear is to focus on the mind where it's coming from, not the people. After all, the people don't know whether you're afraid or not. Eh? So gazing at people's eyes like this is not going to help you so much. We have to focus on where the fear is coming from. It's coming from the mind. That's why it's very important to make the object of fear the object of your meditation, right? Then you become mindful of it. And also be mindful of those moments when there's no fear. Because sometimes fear subsides and you have no fear. And then also you have to be mindful of those moments. Right? This is very, very important. When I used to have fear of talking to people the first time I was talking to Westerners, in U.S.A., there are so many, 100 of them. And my worry was more of my accent, actually. I thought these people are not going to understand anything. This Ugandan English, they are not going to understand it. Everybody has their English, the Singlish, and Malaysian English, and Australian English, and New Zealand English, and South African English, and all that. So I was worried how people are going to perceive me. What I did, I said, I'm going to talk to my brothers and sisters. That's what I did. Are you afraid when you are going to talk to your brothers and sisters? No. Actually, if you have fear of public speaking, enter in a room and say, this is my sister, this is my brother, this is my mother, this is my father. There's no problem. I don't have no problem talking to my mother. I have no problem talking to my father, to my sisters and brothers. And so the problem is that people enter and they just say, I'm going to talk to strangers. Of course, this fear is going to arise if you're going to talk to strangers. But if you're talking to people you know, you don't have fear. You know? Okay, this is a mind state which is called fear. There's a scientific research which has been made. Labeling and mentally noting the emotion helps to sort it out. They have done actually a scientific study, people are going through anxiety, going through emotions like fear and all that. Whenever they labeled it, or let's say they said fear, they were, actually it's amazing how they are overcoming it. But people who just stuck with it without actually identifying it, they are having more fear. They are having more emotions. So I have that scientific research. Actually, it was done in USA. So this means it approves the teaching of the Buddha by making fear the object of meditation, or the emotion the object of meditation. This is very interesting. All right, so the right attitude, again, we have to accept that this is fear arising without pushing it away. Because pushing away things, it's just desire to push away, right? It's a kind of aversion. Also expressing it, indulging in it, that's also not a good, a wise move. And not repressing it or ignoring it, right? We have to address it. Whenever there's fear, we have to address it. So in other words, we didn't understand fear, that this is fear. This is the instruction we find in the Buddha's teaching, this one. This is fear to the extent necessary for further knowledge and mindfulness. Here's a question for you. If you had ever had fear in your life, is that what you do? Oh yeah, I fear, let me get more knowledge about it. Isn't it? Oh, I have fear, let me try to get further mindfulness out of it. Whenever there's fear, we get overwhelmed with it, isn't it? But we can use fear actually to understand it, get further knowledge, how fear affects us, how it affects the body, how it affects the mind. A little bit of investigation is very important to find out how the condition for fear to arise. All right? It's good to find out what are the conditions that actually brought fear to arise. If we don't find out the condition, then we cannot deal with it. Maybe paying unwise attention to the theme of irritation or danger in the present moment. Right? And also condition. Here, the condition for removal of fear is paying wise attention. Right? Be mindful of it. Then condition for non-rising of fear in the future. What are the conditions? When you attain non-returner state, that means third level of enlightenment. Before that, fear is going to arise in one form of fashion. You may think that today you don't have fear because I'm talking about fear in a meditation hall, but wait until it comes. Wait until when it's in front of you, I'm telling you. Oh, I'm telling you. Because you have not reached the non-returner level, there's still a root, which is desire and aversion. What this do is that when fear arises, we actually try to take it easy and try to remember the techniques. So instead of blaming people, oh, why do you have fear? Why do you have fear? Of course they have fear. They haven't attained the third level of enlightenment. Isn't it? Don't blame other people because they have fear. Just know that it's a natural state. I mean, it's an emotional state. And then this is something that we can work on. And also don't blame yourself that you have fear. All what you have to do is to remember to be mindful of fear, and then it will go slowly by slowly. So you have to know when fear arises, affect your body and mind. And also you have to investigate. Oh, I found something like a 3-eye for you to remember. You remember the thing 3-eye here? This is how you should investigate in terms of nature, impermanence, insecurity, and impersonal nature of fear. Okay, here's a question. Is fear personal? No, it's impersonal. It's a state of mind. Fear of separation, fear of these things, it just came due to causes and condition, isn't it? So it will go away due to causes and condition. I think this is very, very important. We tend to forget this, that fear will go due to causes and condition. Ah, do you know this guy? Okay, the fourth technique is called non-clinging to fear or depersonalized fear. In other words, be mindful like this, fear not I, not mine, not myself. Remember, not IMS. I'm putting IMS, right? Not IMS. This is called Insight Meditation Society. I'm a teacher there. Actually, it's a big meditation center in the United States. So you need to remove this conceit. You see this conceit? I. Eh? This is what you call conceit. When you have I, this is conceit. When you have mine or fear's mine, this is craving. And when you have myself, this is wrong view. So we meditate, in other words, to overcome these actually mental states. All right? So do not try to have what you call copyrights of fear. Fear, don't have copyrights. Right? It's just fear. It's arising. And let go of anger because always it leads to afraid. Okay. The fifth technique is actually to reflect. It's called reflection method. When you have fear, it keeps on defiling the mind. So try to let go of it. It degrades the mind, right? And then you cannot do anything. You cannot develop so much when there's a lot of fear. So it degrades you. And also it's dangerous because when you are fear, then it's dangerous. I know people who cannot fly. I know people who cannot fly because they are going to die in airplane. You know what? If I'm to be afraid of flying, that will be terrible because I cannot teach Dhamma. I remember when I was scuba diving instructor in Thailand, we used to have Japanese people coming, and the first they would draw a shark with its teeth like this. They would show it to me. They say, do they have sharks in the ocean? Of course we have, but they don't bite. But they were afraid. I told them that when you stay dry, you don't go diving, coconuts will hit your head. According to statistics in Thailand, 250 people die of coconut hitting. And people who actually have a problem with diving, there are only 6 per year. I remember I didn't actually understand these statistics. So what I was doing, one time I was sitting, booking for a dive for somebody, it fell in front of me. A coconut, a fresh one. It fall in front of me. I said, whoa, that was close. Near miss. So, my friend, I give opportunities to some people in Uganda. They say, I'm afraid of dying. But to use an analogy of Ajahn Brahm has a very, very good solace for people who are afraid of flying. According to Ajahn Brahm, if you fly if you crash in an airplane when you are 2,000 feet over there, there are 2 benefits. One is a cheap funeral, another one near to God. Toshita, okay, for us, let us make it a Buddhist thing. Okay, near to Toshita, Toshita heaven. No need to spend 7 days and all these things. I think that was amazing. Actually, I'm not afraid of them. Me, I'm not afraid of a crash. One time I was flying in Hartford, the plane was about to land like this. All of a sudden, it started taking off. I said, what's going on here? No announcement. I've never been in an airplane when it's about to touch the ground, and all of a sudden, it goes up. Everybody was looking like this. They are crossing themselves. And I say, wow, what's happening here? And all of a sudden, I had an announcement that the airport is a little bit busy. That's why. There was no mechanical fault. My teacher actually had this problem, I think, also. Bhante Gunaratana was in an airplane going to Sri Lanka, and they went via Hawaii. And there was a little bit of fire coming from the engine. And it's amazing how my teacher was so calm. I was so calm and peaceful. That's what he told me. Anyway, let's go to the sixth method, replacement. Can you replace fear with courage, confidence, and calmness? I think that's the best way. If you want to overcome fear, always think its opposite, all right? Another one is called redirection method, where you redirect your mind to something else which is less fear provocative. This is actually from the discourses. There's a discourse called Dajagasutta. You know where the Buddha talks about reflecting on a Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha? Whenever there's a fear, Remember itipiso bagaba araham samma sambudovi jacharan sampano sugatoro kavidu anuttaro purisadama sarati sattadeva manusana buddho bhagavati.
These things we do here every morning. You know? Where is my paper?
You see these things, you have to remember it in Pali language. And also remember it in English. You will not have fear. If you are afraid of separation, if you are afraid of uniting, let's say you are going for interview, remember the qualities of the Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha. It's going to be so peaceful. This is the recommendation from the Buddha himself, actually. We find this in the suttas, where in order to overcome fear, you reflect on the quality of the Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha. Right? This is the refuge. Also, another thing I recommend is to take a deep breath and maintain focus on the breath. Because when the mind is focusing on the breath, it cannot focus on the mental state fear. So at least you have a break. All right? You calm yourself, make yourself calm, and breathing has a calming effect. So we go to number 8. This is called retrace. In other words, trying to find the springboards or cause all the conditions for fear, where fear comes from. This Dhammapada phrase here I'm offering you is called, from affection springs grief, from affection springs fear. For one who is wholly free from affection, there is no fear, there's no grief, right? There's no grief, then fear. So these are all Dhammapada phases. That means if you overcome attachment, lust, and craving, there's no fear. These are the springboards. Then number 9 is making a strong resolve to face fear. This is a strong resolve. Make a commitment to overcome fear every day. This is what we find in the scriptures. The Bodhisattva family determined not to change his posture until fear has subsided. So what happens if you are sitting and meditating and maybe fear comes, or when you are standing? You stay still and make a determination for fear that you are not going to change the posture. This is exactly, Buddha did this before. This is called Bodhisattva. Actually, before he became a Buddha. He was called a Bodhisattva, right? A being who's inclined towards enlightenment, right?
So don't say that, okay, because the Buddha was enlightened, that's how he overcame fear. But before even he became enlightened, when he was still a Bodhisattva, so this is very, very important. Aditana, which is called determination, right? Then this is part of face fear, right? Face everything and rise. Don't freeze in fear. I want to remember this acronym, face everything and rise. So this is a part of your determination, right? And then this is my conclusion. The difficult emotions like fear are beyond our control. However, mindfulness and awareness can make a difference between getting caught up or being free from them. That's my conclusion. Thank you very much for listening.